a joy it is to be here today at Build 2019 doing Azure Friday Live. We've never done it live before. It's amazing. We are here with Asavari Tayal talking about Python and Azure Functions. How are you?
Pretty good. Excited to be here.
Yeah, I'm glad. Thanks for coming to share some of the new things that are happening in Azure Functions for us. You've got a few demos for me. You know, when I tried to go into functions before in the past, and I would say probably maybe a year ago, I make a new function and I get excited about serverless, but then they tell me to put all of my work in this little text box in the Azure portal. And honestly, I kind of left and I haven't, you know, I didn't look at it after that. But I understand that there's been some fundamental changes.
Yeah. Well, if you've been following functions, you might know that we recently announced Functions 2.0, which is cross-platform. What that means is you can develop on any platform. You don't have to be stuck to the browser. Mm. And you can develop with the tools of your choice. So if you're a Python developer and you like Visual Studio Code, you could go in and use the extension to build your function.
I understand that the Azure Functions runtime can even be run on my own computer. Like I could do serverless in the cloud, but on my machine on an airplane.
Exactly. It's open source. So you could run it on your machine. You could run it on an on-premise device. You could containerize it and run it on a Raspberry Pi if you wanted to.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And can an Azure function be complicated? Like I said, I was doing it in the browser in a very small box, but now I can do it in VS Code. Maybe you can show us that.
Sure. All right.
We'll go ahead and switch over to her machine and take a look at that. So we are in VS Code on your Mac.
Yes, and I have my Azure Functions extension installed. And what I'm going to be showing you today is how to develop a Python function app in Visual Studio Code using Functions 2.0.
Functions 2.0.
So what this lovely extension does for us is offers us these friendly utilities to help us work with a function project. So for instance, I can say, hey, I'd like to go ahead and create a new function project. It'll prompt me to pick a directory for my project. Let's go ahead and pick demo one. It'll also ask me for the language I'd like to use for my function app. So Azure Functions supports a wide variety of languages today. Let's go ahead and use Python, which is our new offering. Now, as a next step, I'm going to be prompted to pick a trigger for my very first function in my function project. So we can pick HTTP trigger. We also support a wide variety of other triggers, things like events in Azure Storage, in messaging or eventing systems, Azure Storage, Cosmos DB, Event Grid, Event Hub. And recently, as of 2 days ago, we also added the Kafka trigger. So you're not seeing it here right now because there isn't a template for it, but we're going to be adding a template as well, so to help you get started.
When I saw that dropdown for the first time, it really changed the way that I thought about Azure Functions because, like I told you before, I had the wrong idea. I thought it was a kind of a simple thing for making little HTTP applications, but this is really a fantastic platform for making large event-driven applications, and these are all events that can happen in other Azure services that can then invoke my Azure function.
Exactly, and we're always watching for those events so we can go ahead and provision the resources and run your application.
Fantastic. So what are we going to trigger on?
Let's pick HTTP trigger for our demo today. And now what you'll see is it'll ask me for a name to give my function. Let's just pick the default name, which is HTTP trigger. We'll be prompted to pick an authorization level. What this means is if I picked anonymous, it could be a public endpoint. I could also secure it behind an API key. Or if I wanted some more control like OAuth or AAD authentication, I could pick the admin control as well. For the demo, let's pick anonymous and make it a public endpoint.
All right.
And so what this is doing here, and you'll see this little processing box at the bottom, is create a new function project for us. And so if we go ahead and look at the Explorer, a function project is basically the equivalent of a function application in Azure. It can contain multiple functions that share the same local configuration, hosting configuration, and even the requirements or dependencies that they use.
I see that it's popping up a notification about Python interpreter. Do I need to know about, like, do I have to have Python locally, or does it depend on whether I'm doing the work locally or not?
Well, if you're developing locally, you do need to have Python installed. We already support Python 3.6.
Oh, wow.
What this will do is it'll give me an option of what Python interpreter I want to use. So the extension, the functions extension, already created a virtual environment for us. Mm-hmm. I can go ahead and pick that. If I wanted, I could also pick the Python on my local bin path, depending on what your preference is as the developer.
Okay.
So let's go ahead and pick the virtual environment. And we don't have to worry about this one.
All right.
And so what the next step I can do is, we talked about Azure Functions is open source, right? You can run the functions runtime right here on your local machine without even publishing to the cloud. You can debug and test. And Visual Studio Code makes it so easy that all I need to do is go ahead and press F5 to start the debugger. And if you...
Is this in the cloud or is this local?
This is completely local.
Wow,
so what this did was it started the functions runtime. It started what we call a Python language worker process.
Ah.
And now it's already serving your function on a local hosting endpoint.
Wow.
And we can go ahead and call this function. A cool thing I'll show you today is to set a breakpoint. And so what you need to understand is the functions extension is smart in the sense that it's already attached the Python debugger to the functions process that's running locally.
Okay.
So when I go ahead and call the function, we'd see that it actually breaks on our breakpoint right here, so we can debug view call stack and do all kinds of fancy things as well using.
Yeah, I saw when you hovered over the request there, you got a whole ton of context. I mean, this is full rich debugging, the kind of debugging that a Python person would expect, but now they're not thinking about servers anymore.
Exactly. And so going back to your point about portal development, this is not just limited to the experience that you're seeing in the web browser. This is us bringing functions to the local development that you're used to as a Python developer.
That's really cool.
Yeah. And so if we go ahead and continue and go back to our browser, I can, since this is a Hello World function, give it a friendly name and continue.
So you're passing
again.
Something in as a parameter, as a query string, and then changing it and coming back around the other side.
Exactly.
All right.
So I already have that local hosting endpoint. All you needed to look at, since this function got generated from a template, I do want to walk through a few things that really help you configure the function.
Mm-hmm.
So if you look at the HTTP trigger folder I have right here, that's where my function is actually located, the HTTP triggered function. We've got a script file right here, which is called the dunder init file. And then this other one, which is called the function JSON file. Now, this is the configuration where I actually define the script file that I want to invoke, the Python script file that I want to invoke when my function's executed,
okay.
The trigger that'll invoke my function. So in this case, it's an HTTP trigger. The templates already populate things like, hey, it's supposed to be a GET or a POST request. But you can obviously customize and configure as per your need. You can also define other bindings. In this case, we've already defined the HTTP response. That's what the template populated for us. And if you wanted, you can even go ahead and add new bindings to your function.
This binding thing is really, really powerful. Like, the first thing I thought was, OK, HTTP, HTTP out, some JSON in, some JSON out. But it could be images dropped into storage that then triggered the function, and then the out is another storage bucket.
Exactly. So what we see is people are using functions as the glue between several other services that they may be using in Azure or outside of Azure. So make it super easy with bindings for you to be able to speak with these data sources without having to understand what the Azure storage SDK for Python looks like, what the authentication mechanism is, et cetera. We do all of that for you.
Mm-hmm.
So looking at the Python script here, our entry point actually was the main method, if you noticed. And it already got an input of the HTTP request. This is the trigger that we defined in the function JSON file. And it spits out a response or a return value that's treated as an HTTP response. We already, in fact, give it a root logger in Python. So you can go ahead and start sending logs to the console when running locally and to application insights when running in Azure. It also, since this is a Hello World template, we simply grab a name parameter on the query string and use it to construct an HTTP response that's sent back from the function.
Now, you said this was a Hello World template, but when I go into Azure Functions in the portal, there's a lot of different templates, like there's examples about how to do all kinds of things, including image manipulation or calling cognitive services or calling other Azure services.
Right, exactly. You could start from when I said this is a Hello World template for HTTP. We also have a few other templates available for different event sources. And in fact, I could go back and even say, hey, I'd like to add a new function to the same project. That's available. If you were looking for something a little bit more complex, like an image processing example, we've got this thing called the serverless library that gives you a bunch of samples that the community has contributed to, that we've contributed to, that you can already start using and leveraging.
You had said something earlier about a custom container?
Yeah. So the experience that I showed you right here on the screen is, hey, I'm building my Python script, and that's all I need to do to publish a function.
Right.
But We also have scenarios with Python specifically where folks walk up to us and say, hey, you know, I have a custom OS level dependency, something that doesn't necessarily have to be pip installed, mm-hmm. but something that needs to be apt-get installed, for instance, right? Or a scenario where I'm using a custom distribution of Python, something like the Anaconda distribution maybe,
okay.
Which you guys don't support, you guys as an Azure don't support out of the box. Can I bring in a custom Docker container to support the scenarios? Now, the cool thing with Python is that we actually introduce being able to bring in your custom Docker image and run it serverlessly on the Linux hosting platform.
That's like a moment where we need to pause and think about that for a second, because I think of serverless as hiding computers from me, hiding servers from me, making life really easy. I think of Python as a really high-level language. But what you're giving us is the power of the low level, a native library, a custom container, a custom system call into Linux. But then you're still making it really convenient and really flexible and really scalable by using the functions runtime in the cloud.
Exactly. So you get the very same programming model. In fact, if you like, I can show you a demo of that
as
well.
Let's do it.
OK. Let's switch over from VS Code for a second, because I also do want to show you our command line features. So if you didn't use VS Code and you were more of a command line person,
yep.
and you said, hey, I'd like to use the editor of my choice, or I'd like to use Vim, the same stuff that I was doing in VS Code is also available in the CLI via a utility we call func, or the functions command line tools, functions core tools. And if you look at it, it lets you do all the same things that we were doing in VS Code in the CLI instead.
OK, so I can do the portal, VS Code, or the command line.
You cannot do portal today, portal editing today. That's because we heard feedback from a lot of our Python developers and decided to deprioritize it for now.
Oh, that makes sense. I mean, they're going to spend their time at the command line or VS Code anyway, so you prioritize that for this release.
Exactly.
Okay.
Yeah. So let's go ahead and use our command line now. Say I already have a directory, nothing in it right now. I'd like to create a new function project. So I go ahead and click on Funcinit. And it'll prompt me to pick a language similar to how VS Code did. I can go ahead and do that. Or let me just control C out of that for a second and say, hey, I'd like to initiate a project with a Docker file.
Mm.
So now when I pick Python, what this is going to do is not just populate the simple function settings files for me, but also this Docker file. And if you look at the Docker file right here, it's already got a template where it's extending the functions, the Azure Functions base image, adding some console settings to it, going ahead and setting the directory, and adding your function project and pip installing your requirements. Now, I can go in here and say, hey, I'd like to apt-get install the SQL driver, for instance, mm-hmm. or I'd like to add something that's completely custom to my specific workload right here in this Docker file. And once you customize it, you can go ahead and build the Docker image. And before we do that, one thing you'd notice is we've only initialized the project right now. So let's go ahead and also add a function to that project.
All right.
So func new, and we can go ahead and this time maybe pick a timer trigger function. Now I've not only got my Docker file hosting local settings, but also this timer trigger folder, which actually contains my function. I can go ahead and build the Docker container using the Docker build command that I'm already familiar with, and give it a name. And so this is going to go ahead and build the layers. Since I already had the same image built on my local machine, it didn't take a lot of time since there was nothing custom I was doing right now. And now I can go ahead and push this image to Docker Hub.
And when you push that to Docker Hub, will Azure Functions pick it up and know that it's something that can be used?
Azure Functions won't automatically pick up, but the ID or the identifier you're going to use is this image named right here.
I see. So you're going to push it to Docker Hub, then tell Functions about it. It'll go get it and then start running.
Exactly. So once I have this image ready, I'll go to the portal. And this is the management portal in the management experience in the portal that you might already be familiar with.
Right.
This is the new create blade for Functions. And if you go in here, give your function app a name, you go ahead and pick a subscription, give it a resource group. So let's give it a resource group of build demo. pick Linux because we're running Python on Linux, you have an option of being able to pick either code or Docker image. What that means is code, I'm simply bringing my Python files and I'd like to run them serverlessly. Or the Docker image approach where I can actually go ahead and configure the container that I'd like should run my function.
We've only got a few seconds left, so we're going to have to go and fast forward at this point. So you're putting that into Docker Hub and you're going to go ahead and enter in that tag and you hit apply. It'll pull that down and immediately start running that now custom Docker image in Azure Functions?
Exactly, exactly.
And where can people learn about this new Python ability that we have now in Azure Functions?
Right, so all of our docs talk about Python functions now. We've got two getting started experiences. If you go to docs.microsoft.com, you can start with Visual Studio Code, or you can start with the CLI and build a function. Or if you wanted to do something a little bit more custom, you could go dive into our developer guide to learn more as well.
Fantastic. We're learning all about Python and Azure Functions and the power of serverless here at Azure Friday Live at Build.